Charlie 128.5.
Down 7,028.5 to Charlie 4820.
Delta 1422, turn left, check Los Angeles, VOR, we're in order 7 of Archie.
Alright, left, turn directed in LA, VOR, and return the loop, Southwest, go 1421. Alright, Southwest 1681, 2.5 miles, 5,000.
Southwest 1681, so okay, ready to contact me, 5,000.
5,000, Southwest 1681.
Southwest 2497, or 7,800, 5,000.
Send a mile, Southwest 2497.
Send 1111 there, shuttle 54,
sir. We're about 36, I'll need to hit
7,000. 7,000, we're at 36, sir. South of 1681,
I'll need to hit 6,000. 6,000, south of
16. South of 1422, when you're able to see your guest intersection, we're going to start to make hit 1 and 5,000.
Okay, we're able to take two directions at 1,500 for Delta 1422.
2487,
that's 2,500. 2487, contact
AJ
5,000 and 2,000.
5,000,
2,000. Jet 1136, climb AJ 1,300.
Up to 1,313,
to 1,136. South of 1681, turn left, direct to the Los Angeles, VOR, Oh, yeah, everybody, they're going to
143, clear visual approach, runway 25 left. Southwest, 19359.
80X Live HD, presented by AirDailyX.net, powered by Jetline Systems, broadcasting in prepared V2.2. Welcome aboard.
Well, welcome aboard, ladies and gentlemen. It has been a while since my last broadcast, but I want to take a minute and welcome you to 80X Live HD, powered by Jetline Systems. This is where you, yes, you, sir, get an opportunity to take an in-depth look right in the front seat at the latest products released. Unfortunately, this is not too much latest because I'm a little bit behind the eight ball here with the live streams. It has been a while since I've had the opportunity and the free time to come on and show you some products. So hopefully between today and tomorrow, I'll have an opportunity to sort of get caught up. And of course, the entire purpose of these streams is to help you again get an in-depth look at what is out there, and hopefully gives you a little bit more of an idea of what to expect besides what you would typically find on a web shop product page. So today we are heading out to 29 Palms Magdeburg over in Germany. I've been looking forward to this scenery for a very long time. In fact, I've been cheering this scenery all the way from release, or rather all the way to release, for a long time now. I'm trying to think off the top of my head how long the development process has been with this one. But as you may or may not know, Magdeburg is developed primarily by Captain Sevens. And if you're not sure who Captain Sevens is, Captain Sevens developed a really nice Heringsdorf airport, which is where we happen to be right now. This was the first official release by Captain Sevens, and was released as freeware. I think it's been I want to think off the top of my head. I want to say it's probably been about 2 years since this particular freeware scenery has been released, and certainly blew me away when it first came out for FS9, and then it was later adapted for FSX and prepared. And today we're actually getting a look at the version released for prepared. So again, it is a freeware location, a freeware airport, freeware scenery, and by developer Captain Sevens. So just thinking off the top of my head here, the next project from Captain Sevens, of course, was Magdeburg, and the product had been in development for quite a while. In fact, Heringsdorf here had been in development for quite a while, and obviously when it's an independent developer, they work at their own schedule and, of course, at their own free time and abilities. So quite naturally, Heringsdorf here did take a while to get released, but I remember covering this particular release on the old AirDailyX blogger. Sorry, for those of you who've been following AirDailyX for more than, I want to say, 2 years, we had an old blogger website, and this was one of the products that was featured on the old website. So if you haven't seen this covered at AirDailyX.net, that's because this has been out for a while. So nevertheless, Captain Sevens blew away a lot of people as his first release as a independent scenery developer. Quality is spectacular, especially for free. And what can I say? So he set out again to do his next project, which was again Magdeburg. And again, because he's working at his own pace, it's something that sort of took a while for him to get out there, and I think he'd been working on this for quite a while, Magdeburg. And so at some point within the last, I want to guess, maybe 3 to 5 months, collaboration formed with developer 29 Palms. And if you're not familiar with 29 Palms, then all I can tell you is you are definitely missing out on some incredible stuff. I'm talking about Berlin Brandenburg. I'm talking about Skiathos. I'm talking about Mykonos. I'm talking about 29 Palms over in the California desert. about a couple hours drive from where I live. So definitely, 29 Palms has developed a lot of incredible sceneries and has also collaborated with a number of developers to get a number of scenery products out, including Orbix. And if you are a fan of Orbix products, then you must be aware of, Southampton and what's the other airport? Don't draw a blank. Sunborough? Is it Sunborough? If I'm getting it right, up in Scotland there. So definitely 29 Palms works with a number of developers. And again, most recently, Captain Sevens with Magdeburg. So I thought I would take a minute and come on down to Hearing Surf. That way you can just get an idea and know who Captain Sevens is and what they have done in the past. Now, I'm not entirely sure if Captain Sevens is going to be continuing this collaboration with 29 Palms or not. I certainly hope so. I don't know if Magdeburg was sort of a one-time deal to get the scenery released. I'm not really sure. I certainly hope that the collaboration with 29 Palms continues, because I think it's something that's very, very important when developers collaborate. Products get out faster, and of course, 29 Palms has a tremendous libraries package, and of course they have their own add-on managers and things of that nature. Not add-on managers, but control panels where you can control the different scenery elements, such as animated or static traffic around the airport, birds, people, all of that stuff, including, of course, the seasons. Now, in this particular case with Heringsdorf, to install this scenery, you actually had to go in and install the different seasons. So, for example, I have the summer season here. If I wanted winter, then I would have to install manually in the scenery library the winter textures and deactivate the summer texture. So for a lot of people, that can be a real pain in the ass, especially if you forget to change your seasons. So in this particular case, with joining 29 Palms, now there's a control panel where you can actually go in and adjust all that stuff manually with the scenery, the manager there. So here we are in our little Captain Sim 737-200. I decided we would do a quick flight from Heringsdorf over to Magdeburg. It's a very, very short flight, so it's a great opportunity to show off both products. So with that in mind, let's go ahead and get this show on the road. Let me just go ahead and check my sounds here. I cannot hear my little airplane. I know it's in there somewhere. I actually can't hear the simulator. That's weird. Let me just double check the sound. Sorry about that. There we go. So hopefully you can hear the aircraft a little bit. Hopefully it's not too loud. I know sometimes the airplane can overtake my voice, which is probably not a bad thing if you don't want to hear me running my mouth for the next hour or so. Okay, so we're going to go ahead and taxi, and as we do so, we can kind of just get a look at the airport here. Again, this is freeware, and if you want to download this product, I believe you can get it from the website. It is Captain7, the number 7.de. It is a German website. And it is free. So be sure to pop on over and check that out, especially if you like to do a lot of flights around Germany. As we all know, Orbix is currently in the process of delivering Germany as the next FTX region. And if I'm not mistaken, it's going to be done in two parts. So I'm not entirely sure which part of Germany will be released first. I don't know if that was announced or not. But nevertheless, for those of you who enjoy Germany, as an FTX region by Orbix, you're already going to have just literally handfuls of airports and airfields to choose from. Obviously, Aerosoft has released a number of airfields in Germany, across Germany. Then you have the German airports team and all of their terrific airports. So nevertheless, you have the Captain Sevens, Heringsdorf here, along with Magdeburg, which is what we are en route to today. So that'll also give us an idea of what's out there. And of course, I am using OpenLC Europe, so even if, naturally none of us have FTX Germany yet. So if you have FTX, or rather OpenLC Europe, then this gives you an opportunity to see just how the scenery blends in with the terrain there. Just taking a look at the texturing on some of these objects, the hangars, so on and so forth. I mean, the ground textures aren't super duper, but definitely the textures on the buildings are very well done. I mean, especially for a freeware airport. I've seen a lot of stuff up on SimMarket, that doesn't come close to this. And, you know, the developers are charging money for it. So that's always something that makes me cringe personally. I hate when I see products for sale that really should be released for free, to be honest. But this is something that could have been put for sale. I mean, I could see something like this on SimMarket going for like 8 or 12 euros, something like that. I mean, it's a very small airport, not a whole lot to see, but definitely just very, very decent quality. And on the other side of the scale, I have seen a lot of incredibly freeware-looking, or rather payware products that are worse than freeware that are for sale. So that's another side of it. So we have a lot of freewares out there that are getting charged that shouldn't, and a lot of or paywares that shouldn't be getting charged that are, and a lot of freewares that should be getting charged that aren't. Definitely hearing Zorf here is the latter. This is a very, very tremendous looking freeware. The apron and runway textures are actually very nice. The only thing the ground is lacking here really is just volumetric grass. I think if this airport had some volumetric grass, I think that's what's the only thing that's kind of lacking in this particular scenery. Volumetric grass, that's really the only thing that's lacking in my opinion. So again, Heringsdorf, a small airport, not much to look at, but definitely for what is there, it's very, very well done. And also want to take a moment to welcome some of you into the chat who are watching live. Seabir Hansen, if I'm pronouncing that right. Welcome aboard, Captain Gombo and Yun. Yun tuning in from Switzerland. Gombo from Germany, as always. Appreciate you guys coming in. There's a question there saying, talking about free, have I tried the Airports of Norway by Andrew Thompson? I have not tried them. I have seen them, and I definitely appreciate the effort on behalf of the developer. The freeware quality is not really in-depth enough for me to install them. I didn't think that the quality was bad for freeware, just not something that really sparked my interest. So I have not tried them. I did look at some of the screenshots, though, and again, I do applaud the developer's efforts. It's just not something that really reached out to me or really appealed to me to go in and download all those airports. But as far as flying around Norway goes, I've been enjoying a lot of really fun flights from the Yo Airlines airports, such as Oslo, Bergen, and Trondheim, which is one of the older airports, as well as Tromsø. So those are really the only airports I've been enjoying in Norway so far. And then I fly outside of Norway into Finland, where I like to enjoy the A-Flight Helsinki-Vanta, which, by the way, A-Flight, don't know if they're still around or not, but what an incredible development team those guys were. I certainly hope they come back with something again. And as far as Sweden goes, haven't been really flying into Sweden, hoping for a new Arlanda. We'll see if it happens. And, of course, we have Denmark with Copenhagen. And so that's pretty much a lot of my Nordic slash Scandinavian flying. All right, we are all lined up, so let's go ahead and get underway and head on over to Magdeburg. Sold 737-200s like a herd of turtles. I selected this aircraft for today's stream because I thought having the old classic Lufthansa as a tribute to the developers. So I thought this might be something fun for this particular very, very short leg between these two airports. And as we depart, we can start taking a look at OpenLC Europe. Let's get a look at how everything sort of blends in together around the airport there. Not too bad, actually. The only thing here is obviously the photoreal terrain around the airport is a little bit brighter than OpenLC, but as far as blending goes, doesn't look bad at all. And the area actually departing out of Magdeburg is actually quite scenic as well. Just go back over to the external view here. If you do not have OpenLC Europe, I have to tell you, you are strongly, seriously missing out on a terrific product. Just look at that quality. Of course, OpenLC Europe is not 100% accurate, but it looks a billion times better than default. And of course, once FTX Germany comes along, then that will definitely add a much greater level of accuracy. I would say OpenLC Europe gets you like 80 to 85% of the way, and then FTX gets you up to about roughly 98%. And I think I would leave that remaining 2% for PhotoReal, which just gives you 100% accuracy. Just taking a look at the area around here, I mean, everything just looks very, very nice. I love flying around Europe with OpenLC. It does amazing wonders over the default textures. It really does. And if you have it, then you already know what I'm talking about. So like I said, this is going to be kind of a short hop, so we're not going to climb too high. 10,000 feet should just about do it. And as we level out here, I'll take a look at some of your comments as we continue to make our way over to Magdeburg. And Captain Gumbo saying, I love the old Lufthansa livery. Have you seen the LH Retro 747? You know what? I'm actually a little bit disappointed about that. The 747-800 was the aircraft that Lufthansa had designated for Los Angeles, which is my home airport, LAX. And with the exception of the 747-800 cargo freighters, which we see about maybe four of those a day, NCA, Cathay Pacific, Korean Air, and there's one other airline that flies. Oh, Cathay Pacific Cargo, Korean, NCA, and Cargolux. I think those are the four that have daily services with the 747-800 cargo freighter. But as far as the 747 passenger variant, Lufthansa was the only airline that was flying that to LAX. So it was really nice because, I mean, it's kind of sad. I mean, the 747-800 came a little bit late in life. I think if it had been introduced about 5 years before it had, I think it would have been maybe a little bit more popular. Maybe it would have gotten more orders. But nevertheless, I was just really excited about Lufthansa because they were flying it to LA. And I was actually really considering buying a ticket to Frankfurt for, you know, a few days. Not really to visit Germany, don't get me wrong. I love Germany. but to really get an opportunity to fly on that 800 because no one else is flying it here. And just my luck, right when they introduced that retro livery, they actually canceled the 747 service and replaced it with an A380. And I have to be honest with you, we really don't need any more A380s at LAX right now. Right now, we have like 13 flights a day with A380s. I mean, that's enough. I would have loved to have at least one 747-800, especially considering the fact that a lot of airlines are retiring their 747s now. A lot of them aren't really flying them anymore. So as far as LAX goes, they're all really disappearing, and it's really sad that they're disappearing. So it's getting more and more difficult to get a ticket on a 747 anymore. I mean, Qantas is still flying them. United has the occasional 747 flights. Delta's retiring them. Who else is still flying 747s here? Man, it's hard to think. I mean, British Airways have replaced them with the A380. So, you know, I guess Lufthansa just gave me some hope that there's still an opportunity to fly a 747. But they took that away. So Qantas will still be flying 747s, I think, for another 5 years before they phase the rest of theirs out. So, yeah, I was a little bit disappointed. So, in long answer to your question, Captain Gumbo, I have seen the pictures online, but I haven't seen it in real life of that retro livery. And, again, I am a little bit disappointed about that. But, yeah, it looks really nice. It really does. Another question from I Love Q400 says, have I tried V-Creations? I don't know, Burgess? I'm not sure what that is. That's a good question. No, I haven't tried that. I don't think I've heard of that. V-Creations Burgess. You can shoot me an email at airdailyx.net. On any page, there's a button there that says Contact Us. And you can send me a contact with that information. I'd be happy to check it out. And Sieber Hansen is saying, well, you'll also have Orbix, Narvik, and Bodo. Well, I'm certainly hoping that Narvik comes along soon. That's been a long wait. And I think that's one of the reasons why Orbix has sort of changed their philosophy as it pertains to how they announce projects. I think one of the reasons is because of Narvik. It was announced so long ago. And, you know, it's funny, someone recently made a comment that the recently released screenshots didn't look much more advanced than the screenshots that were released like 8 or 9 months ago. So without a doubt, Narvik is a long way coming. It's been quite a long wait, and it's one of the airports that I'm most looking forward to this year. So really looking forward to that. Bodo, that's something that I'd been following, I think, for close to 3 years now. Of course, that's going to be an Orbix project. But if you look in terms of scale, the differences between Narvik and Bodo, and I know that Tor does watch the stream, so I love you, Tor, you know that. But the differences between Narvik and Bodo is far, far larger of a project than Narvik is. So if you look at how long it's taking Narvik to come along, I can only imagine that definitely when Tor gets back on working on Bodo, it will probably take a lot longer than Narvik. So I'm not really optimistic that Bodo will come this year. I'm hoping it'll come next year, but you know, fingers crossed. But I try not to hold my breath too much, because as you all know, I get really excited about a lot of these things, and the longer the wait, the greater the anticipation, the more the disappointment when another year passes and you don't have it. But yeah, Narvik and Bodo are two that I'm definitely looking forward to, besides a newer version of Trondheim, which I'm really excited about as well, which I hope comes after Daytona. And boy, I can tell you, that was definitely a surprise, I think, for a lot of us, that Yo Airland would bring along an American scenery. And my understanding is that Joe is actually doing some flight training down at Daytona and decided to develop the airport. So really, really excited about that, and that is also high on my list. So after Yo returns back to Norway, I am looking forward to a new version of Trondheim Barnes, which I know is not the correct way to pronounce it, but you'd have to swing me over the head with a stick to try to get me to pronounce anything in Norwegian correctly. Oh, and Yenna's reminding me that KLM still flies a 747. In fact, yeah, I don't think KLM will be replacing that 747 to LAX anytime in the future. I do miss the MD-11. KLM stopped flying the MD-11 here. Well, I want to say it was maybe close to 6 or 7 years ago. And then, of course, Martin Air used to fly their MD-11 cargoes. I don't know if Martin Air is still in business or not, but they used to fly their MD-11 cargo freighter here. And that's another livery and aircraft that I'm missing at LAX. Luckily, FedEx is still flying MD-11s. But as far as passenger MD-11s go, after Varig went bankrupt and Worldwide, or World Airways, which used to be a charter airline, once they disappeared, pretty much MD-11 passenger versions just disappeared. One thing about the MD-11, though, man, the APU on that thing is so freaking loud. I don't like to go anywhere near that thing. It's the freaking APU is louder than the engines on the MD-11, if you ask me. But another aircraft that I sorely miss. LFQ400 says Martin Air is still alive. Is the passenger version still alive, or are we just talking about the cargo version? I really don't remember. I thought the passenger version disappeared. I think they were doing flights out of Amsterdam to like South America and like the Caribbean and stuff. But are you sure they're still? Maybe they're just still flying cargo sorties. I don't know. But I always loved that Martin Air livery. So kind of sad to see them go. I still have some Martin Air Gemini jets in the closet somewhere. So you know, once I get my new house and get my display case, I'll get to relive some old Martin Air. But yeah, another sad airline disappeared, unfortunately. Here we are, just moving back to the external view again, taking another look at OpenLC Europe. I have to imagine all of you guys watching. I'm sure you have to have this. This is just really, really well done. And if you caught the news on AirDailyX.net this week, Frank, what is his last name? I can't think of his last name, but one of the developers for Orbix is looking to do another mountain range. So I know that some of the options in the voting poll over there definitely looks like more European coverage. So I'm very interested to see what might be covered. I think some of the mountains around Bavaria might be interesting as well. At least for Germany, maybe the Pyrenees. But someone pointed out a very interesting point, because my favorite areas to fly around the Alps is the Swiss Alps and the French Alps, especially around the Alps airports such as Courchevel, Alpe d'Huez, so on and so forth. And but from what I understand, Frank already released his freeware, which covers like Mont Blanc and a lot of those mountain ranges over in France, but apparently they're not compatible with the LLH Creations version, so that kind of sucks. I am a pretty big fan of the France VFR, what do they call that, 3D autogenosis, or what do they call that thing now? I think I'm getting autogenesis with Earth simulations confused with Latin, or not Latin VFR, with France VFR, or VFR France, whatever it is. What do they call it? 3D automation. But a lot of their releases lately have been like just photo scenery without the buildings and the autogen. So I'm hoping, or at least I'm waiting for them to add their 3D automation technology to the Alps regions, because I think LLH Simulations is more likely to work with them in terms of airport compatibility. So we wait. And Pratt is asking, is this Captain Sim 737? Yes, it is. I bought this thing about a month ago, and I've been putting a lot of hours on it. Very decent add-on. I have this one, and I have the Milvis 737. And I guess I like Captain Sim's exterior model a little bit better, but both terrific add-ons. The systems on the Milvis version a little bit more in-depth than the Captain Sim, but, I mean, for the most part, it's a 737-200, so it's not all that complicated to fly, really. And Laguna's asking, where am I heading? Today we are featuring Captain Sevens and 29 Palms. So our departure airport was Heringsdorf in northern Germany, to the north there, and we are now flying down to Magdeburg, which was released again by Captain Sevens and 29 Palms. So Heringsdorf was a freeware scenery released a couple of years back, And that was Captain Seven's first project, and then he started in with Magdeburg. And at some point, he collaborated with Lars of 29 Palms, and they released it under the 29 Palms brand. So I thought it would be quite fitting to pair these two airports for today's live stream and overview. And as far as these live streams go, again, it's been a while. Ooh, I'm in overspeed here. Slow that down. It's been a while since I've been able to do it. I don't know of any other flight simulation news sites that have ever done this sort of thing before, just actually showing off the sceneries as opposed to just flying around. But one of the German sites, I guess they liked my idea and adopted it for themselves. So I noticed recently another German site decided to use the idea and start flying around airports with helicopters and showing off the scenery. So it's nice to see these other German websites following AirDailyX. Always fun. And Magdeburg does come with a control panel. There's a lot of things you can add and delete, a lot of features as a part of the scenery. And I can't run it when the simulator is running, but when we go to change seasons, because I think we are going to take a look at winter. As far as spring and autumn goes, if you buy the product, I'll let you explore that on your own. But we will take a look at winter, so at some point we will shut down the simulator and pull up the winter textures, and at that point we'll take a look at the control panel so you can see a lot of the options included. Another thing I like about Captain Sim's airplanes is they really do go above and beyond and add all these extra features such as fully modeled cabins and stuff. I know a lot of people couldn't probably care less about this sort of thing. And they always put some kind of weird Russian, because Captain Sim is a Russian company. They always got some kind of Russian crap, some kind of poster or some junk that they like to put up there. And I think they usually model the lavatories too. Let's see if the door opens. Yeah, they they really do like to go in and let's see. They really like to go in and model the lavatories and everything. You can close the door here and take a crap. I guess when you're on those long hauls, having the entire airplane model gives you something more to do. But what I also really like about the fact that they do this, and by modeling the interior of the aircraft, is it does give you a feeling like there is something behind you. Does this move? No. I don't know. I hope I'm not clicking something in the flight deck by doing this. Oh, wait. Oh, this moves. Oh, look at that. There you go. So the galley cart is actually animated. I think this one was animated on my 767 or my 757 version too. Let's see, any of these cupboards open up? I thought I saw the little... Well, look at that. There's a little seam there in the floor. I don't know what that drags, but I did see the little thumb thing pop up. Or is it the... Oh, I see. I guess that is... Oh, okay. I guess we were clicking something back here. Oh, there we go. So all the sunshades, I think, open and close. You can click and drag those up or down. And then you get all of these overhead bins. Let's see. Take a seat and look out the window as we fly over the German countryside. Let's see. Let's come back over here. A couple of tray tables down. No, can't lift the tray table. I guess some are just up and some are down, huh? There we are. The German countryside breezing by really quickly beneath our wings here. And Seabor Hansen is asking, have I tried Orbig's John Mann? Not sure what that is. Captain Gumbo is saying LH-456-457 is operated by A380. 450-451 is operated by 747-800. I can tell you right now that there is no 747-800 coming into LAX. The A340, whatever aircraft goes to Munich, that or whatever flight number that is, that's the A340. That's the A340-600, I think. Right now, so maybe they haven't replaced the 747 yet. I thought they replaced it already. I know that they are replacing it. I thought they did it already. So maybe the flight to Frankfurt is still a 747-800. If that's the case, then I've got to get down to the airport and do some spotting to see that livery before they take it away. But my understanding was that they took it away already. But with that said, I cannot actually say that I've seen the Lufthansa A380 yet. So, yeah, maybe you're right, Gumbo. Maybe the A380 hasn't arrived yet. So maybe I still have some time before it disappears. The 747. All right, let's make our way back up to the flight deck here. This is a scary sight, walking to the flight deck and like there's no one here. And the plane is flying. Quick, we need someone to fly the plane. Oh, I'll save the day. All right, there we are. All right, let's close that door so no one tries to storm the cockpit. Not that there's anyone back there. Yeah, gotta love that old Lufthansa livery. Würzburg City Jet. Nice. This flight's a little bit longer than I thought. I didn't really pay close attention when I put the flight plan together. I guess I could have gone to a little bit higher altitude. Of course, it's nice to see the countryside. Oh, whoa, I opened a door somehow. How the hell did I do that? Depressurize. Oh, actually, no, we're too low. We're not even pressurized anyway at this altitude. Huh? Let's close that door. There we go. Yeah, we don't want to keep that open, do we? All right, we're about roughly 15 minutes away from Magdeburg. So my other plan today was I really wanted to do the Dream Flight Liberia scenery. So that was my plan today, but they sent it, and unfortunately the link that they sent, I hadn't downloaded it yet because I was really busy, so the link that they sent had already expired. So I was going to do them both, but I've already spoken to the developer, so they're going to send another copy of it. And depending on when he sends it, will determine if I'm able to get to that today. Another aircraft I wanted to get to was the Milvis P-38 Lightning. Unfortunately, I'm still using Prepared V2.4 because I have so many add-ons installed. I'm not really ready to go through and have to install all that stuff from scratch again. So I'm holding out for the next big P-3D update. So as a result, for whatever reason, their P-38 doesn't work with V2.4, and I've already had a few people ask me if I'm going to do a live stream and review it, and yes, I am, but it's going to have to come down to when I am able to get P-3D V2.5 fully installed. I have tested it in FSX, even did some dogfighting. Problem with streaming with FSX is for some reason, whenever I go full screen, it cuts out the stream, like the stream just goes blank. So, and I can't really fly in windowed mode because you get all this V-sync rippling and all these stutters and stuff because that's just FSX, I guess. So I don't get this good clear quality that you see here in Prepared when streaming in FSX. So I do have the Steam version of FSX running as well. I haven't tried to stream the Steam version yet. Blah, blah, blah. That's a tongue twister. I have not tried to stream the Steam version. There we go. Yet. But I am looking into that. And if that works, then I'll definitely look into to doing it that way. So we'll see how it goes. Oh, this thing reset my eye point. That's another problem in Prepared V2.4 that was corrected in 2.5. You see those long lines down there? Those are bridges, and that's just a bug from Prepared. Those ugly bridges. So I definitely need to get that update installed. But again, of all the add-ons that I have, it's just going to be a nightmare, and it's not something I'm looking forward to. And I tend to have far more add-ons than the average user because developers send me a lot of stuff. And I get them installed, and then I wait till I have the free time to review them or do a live stream of them. So, yeah. This looks like a Lufthansa commercial. It's like the plane flying into the... And then it, like, banks left. This is like a 1980s Lufthansa commercial here. Actually, I think the Lufthansa was flying these old 300s like in the 90s, weren't they? Yeah, I think it took them a minute to retire these old bad boys. Let's see. Oh, John Mayen is the freeware distributed by Orbix. Sorry, his name didn't ring a bell at first. Yeah, you know, I actually did try the scenery. It's not bad. It's really mostly just the photoreel of the island and the volcano there. There are some slight 3D objects along with the runway. It's an interesting flight. I guess like maybe from Iceland or something like that. I did check it out. Very, very interesting. I mean, it's not something that I got like super duper excited about. When I got there, but it was certainly an interesting flight. You know, I wouldn't recommend trying to fly a jet. In fact, when I flew there, I flew the Captain Sim 737 there, and that was very interesting, let me tell you. You know, something more appropriate might be like the Twin Otter or something like that. But, you know, it's way out in the middle of nowhere. But definitely a good quality freeware, for sure, for those who are interested in flying all the way out to that remote location. Okay, so they did take away the 747, but they're bringing it back in the summer. Yeah, I mean, we're running into summer now. I mean, because Air Berlin always flies to LAX during the summer, and they've already started their flights already. So I think yesterday I saw an Air Berlin A330 sitting out there. Can someone tell me what the hell that logo is on the tail? I can't seem to figure out what the hell that is, that funny-looking logo. To be honest, I miss the old Air Berlin colors. But I can't seem to figure out what that logo thing is on the tail. It just looks so weird to me. It doesn't seem to make any sense. Oh, I didn't know that. So Gumbo was saying Munich is Airbus only. And Frankfurt is A380s and all Boeing aircraft. I didn't know that. Very interesting how Lufthansa orchestrates that. I mean, obviously, Lufthansa has to show some loyalty towards Airbus because, obviously, Airbuses are made in Germany. But Lufthansa is also very loyal to Boeing as well. Because, to be honest, it didn't seem to make sense to buy the 747-800. But I will say this. You know, I think Lufthansa and Qantas are the dumbest two airlines in the world for not operating the 777. I just don't understand that. Neither one of them, I mean, those are two of the world's, you know, greatest airlines, and neither one of them want the 777. I mean, you know, we have the 777 freighter of Lufthansa that comes to LAX, and that flight comes several times a week, actually. And the Lufthansa colors on the 777 is just so fucking beautiful. Like, Oh my God, it's really just ripping me apart. I can't figure out why they don't see the need for the 777 in their fleet. And the same goes for Qantas. Virgin Australia obviously operating the 777-300. And they're burning a whole lot less fuel than those fat A380s are, I can tell you that. But, yeah, those two airlines, they don't want the 777. That's really sad because I'd love to see the Qantas and Lufthansa on a proper passenger version of the 777. Oh, well. Laguna saying maybe the logo for Air Berlin stands for AB. I don't know what that logo stands for, but it's not. It's definitely not letters. It's like some weird circle thing with a bunch of swiggles and circles. I don't know if that's supposed to be like a sun and waves or what. I'm not sure what that is. Gumbo says they already have the 8340-300 and 3330s. I'm wondering when Lufthansa is going to retire the A340-600. That's what I'm curious about. That thing is not the greatest airplane in the world, I can tell you that. I was a manager for Virgin Atlantic many, many years ago, right when the A340-600 was first introduced into the fleet. And prior to that, we had a 747 in the morning and an A340-300 in the afternoon. And we used to get a lot of complaints from people. They didn't like flying on the A340-300 from Virgin Atlantic. But nevertheless, they eventually swapped out both aircraft with two A340-600s. And I got to tell you, the day that thing arrived was the day hell walked on earth. That A340-600 was a nightmare. I mean, like, the 747, it would come and it go, and it would come and go, and 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 come and go. And then maybe once or twice every 6 months or so, we would have a small tech issue that couldn't be sorted out within 30 minutes. The day on day one, we got that A340-600. I mean, we already had a 2-hour delay. And we were looking at average delays of 45 minutes to an hour almost with every flight. I remember one day we were just getting ready to depart the A340-600. Everyone was on board. And the engineer calls me outside, and I go, "What's wrong?" He says, "You might want to take a look at this." And I go out there, and there's like a 2-foot gash in the side of the fuselage. Like, no one knows where this gash came from because it's on the side of the aircraft where there's no service equipment. It's just this big hole in the plane. Like, where the hell did this come from? No one had a clue. So naturally, that plane was delayed for 3.5 hours while we called Airbus for them to just turn around and say, "Speed tape the fucker and get it out of there." So, but just weird issues with that A340-600. So I have flown a lot of Airbuses, and this is what I'll say. Of all the Airbuses I've flown, and I've flown almost the entire fleet, with the exception of, I think, the A380 and the A330. I've flown on all the others. It's a nice plane to fly on as a passenger. I've never had any issues, any delays or anything as a passenger flying on an Airbus. But working with it, it's a nightmarish plane to work with. Oh my God, I can't stand working with it. But flying on it, it's been very, very reliable, Airbuses in general. So, and I've even flown on the old A300s and A310s. So, but yeah, I mean, flying on them is great, but working with them, not so much. I've just found that mechanical-wise, they're just not as reliable as Boeing's. I mean, even like the old 767s, I mean, those things would come and go. And I remember the guy, the mechanic from Hawaiian Airlines came over one day, and he goes, "Man, you guys are just always having problems with these A340s, huh?" And I'm like, "Yeah." And he's like, "Man, we got these 767s for Hawaiian. We've been flying these things for 20 years, and we never have any problems with them." But nevertheless, I really didn't like the A340-600 too much. But Virgin's still flying them. And Lufthansa still flying them, too. And those are the only ones that are still flying them in LAX anymore. All the other carriers that had them, they all dropped it. They dropped it like it's hot. So, those are the only two now that we see. And once Lufthansa drops theirs and Virgin drops theirs, that's it. No more A340-600. I think the last airline to fly it before they dropped it was like China Eastern, I think. And they've dropped theirs, too. So, not seeing too much of those anymore. Ogumbo saying Lufthansa ordered the 777-9. Oh, that's nice. In Laguna, or what is it? Laguna? Iguna? Something? He's saying the circle stands for an airplane window. Okay, so if that's the case, even though it's kind of a lopsided airplane window, what's that stuff outside the window that we're looking at? Is that supposed to be like a sun and waves, or is that supposed to be terrain or what? I'm curious what that is on the outside, out of curiosity. By the way, can you guys hear that airplane at all? I'm not sure if you can hear it or not. Adjusting the sounds for the stream can always be kind of weird. Oh yeah, Pratt's pointing out Air Canada's A340-500 didn't last long. Same thing with Singapore. Man, they were quick to get rid of that thing, weren't they? Yeah, because I remember the A340-500, that was like an all business class sort of setup, direct from LA to Singapore. And yeah, they got rid of that thing pretty quick. As a matter of fact, I was there the very night the A340-500 got the water cannon salute at LAX. Singapore Airlines was the first to bring it. Actually, now that I think about it, Singapore... Oh, no. Thai Airways brought the A340-500 too. Yeah, Singapore Airlines and Thai. And both of them have scrapped them for the 777-300. So there you go. Once I think Boeing released the 777LR, I don't think the A340 series just had much of a chance anymore. But nevertheless, I'm a fan of all airplanes, really. Even ones I wouldn't fly on. Like, I wouldn't fly on a Russian plane. Maybe the Sukhoi Superjet, but I wouldn't fly on, like, any of those Aleutians or Tuplovs. But I'm still a fan of them. I think they're exciting airplanes. They're certainly different than Western aircraft, but I wouldn't fly on one. No siree. Those things crash way too much. I hear too much about them things crashing. I mean, most of the time, it's like pilot error, maintenance error, but who cares what the reason is if, you know... It's crashing for a reason it shouldn't be crashing for. Oh, it's... Okay, so the thing stands for an A? I don't know. That's, the whole thing is weird. I don't get it. I don't understand it, but... It's an A, it's a window. It's an oval. Gombo says a 777-300ER was better than Boeing expected. Well, it's funny because when I worked for Emirates... at the time, we were bringing two 777-200LRs because at the time, flying the A340-500, that's just something that burned way too much fuel because of the four engines, and so Emirates refused to fly their A340-500 to LA. And if you recall, Boeing went on strike back in 2008, and I remember because. We had already announced our launch dates for Emirates direct from Dubai to LAX, and we had to cancel and postpone the launch dates because the Boeing engineers or the Boeing teams or whatever you call it, they all went on strike, and the strike kept dragging out and dragging out. So as a result, Emirates was not getting the 777-200LRs, and yet at any point they could have decided, all right, we'll stick the A340-500 on it because that has the equal range. But they refused. They just said, fine, we'll just postpone the thing and push it back. And then when we finally got the 200LRs, they only operated for like maybe 2 years. And, you know, it got to the point where it just wasn't big enough. So they took a chance and they just said, you know what, we're gonna deploy the 300 on that thing. And they did, the 300ER. And at the time, no one was flying the 300ER for, you know, 17-hour flights. I mean, no one was doing that. So Emirates decided, you know what, we're going to do it. So they started it at San Francisco first, because obviously San Francisco is closer to Dubai than LAX is, with a difference of like 45 minutes. So they started deploying them to San Francisco, and those things were barely making it. But they learned that, you know, the aircraft does work. So then they started putting it on LAX, and that's what flies out of LAX. Up until they replaced that with the A380, and it's kind of sad because a friend of mine is a pilot for Emirates, and he stopped flying to LAX once they replaced it with the A380, and I told him, dude, just, you know, go fly the A380 from now on, and he said, I won't go anywhere near the A380. No, there's not a chance in hell. So, so unfortunately, no more 777s. And even the A380, that's a freaking stretch for that big freaking tall drink of water, that fat thing. But yeah, they're flying that thing nonstop to LAX now too, so go figure that out. Boy, look at my angle of attack here. I'm busy talking and not paying attention. The thing about the 777, and I remember my first time flying on the 777, which was the when I first started with Emirates, actually. It was my first time on a 777. And I got to tell you, you don't feel like you're on it. Well, granted, I was in business class, but you don't feel like you're in an airplane when you're on that thing. It just doesn't feel like it. Like, I remember flying on 727s. And when you're on a 727, that thing was loud and it was bumpy, and that thing gave you a real shake and it made you feel like you were going fast through the air. So the 777 really does show you just how much Boeing has come along in terms of how, you know, developing aircraft, because I can tell you the 777, you get on that thing and it just doesn't feel like you're on an airplane. You don't feel anything. You hardly hear it. Like, the engines are like this. You're like, are there fucking engines? But you see those big ass GE90s back there, and it's like, ooh. It's like your next door neighbor's vacuuming their house. You don't even hear the engines hardly. When you hit turbulence, it somehow manages to hit turbulence smooth. I don't know. And the thing lifts off the air. It's like, okay, are we still on the ground? Or are we in the air yet? You know, you have to look out the window. Oh, we're flying now. Okay. It's just, it doesn't. I mean, for a passenger, yeah, it's the best airplane in the world. But for someone who loves planes, you just don't feel like you're flying anymore. I don't know if that makes any sense or not. But it's just, it's a little too quiet and a little too smooth for my taste. And I'm one of those kind of people where I like turbulence. I mean, the second that plane gets to rocking, I gets to sleeping. So that thing is like a rocking crib whenever we hit turbulence, especially over the North Atlantic. But yeah, you just don't feel like you're in a plane. And when you're locked up in that thing for 17 hours, you know, you walk right off like you weren't even in it. You know, it's a great plane. What can I say? But I miss the old days of like 727s or like the 737-200 here. I miss just good old loud, shaky, banging airplanes, you know, make you feel like you're flying in something. But those days are long gone. Sadly. Oops, sorry, I'm turning my head. I didn't realize I'm turning my track IR too. Sorry about that. Happy Metal, welcome aboard. And again, for those of you who are joining us, today's stream is actually about 29 Palms Magdeburg. At the moment, I'm just flying around. We flew in today from We flew in today. Actually, that's the airport right underneath us. We flew in today from Heringsdorf, from Captain Sevens. And the point of today's stream was to just kind of show off what Captain Sevens has developed in the past. And now that they've kind of joined up forces with 29 Palms, I thought it would be a great idea to show off both. Wait, that's not the airport. That can't be it. That doesn't look right. Uh-oh. Let me check my scenery library. Something is wrong. Oh, crap. Something is not right. Where is it? Yeah, I see it there. It's in the scenery library. So why can't I see it? Oh, wait a minute. You know what? I know why. I know what's going on. My dumbass, that's not the right airport. You guys see how prepared I am when I do these damn streams. I am never prepared. I'm like, that's not my airport. This is, however, the city of Magdeburg, but that's not my airport. So at least we get to see what Magdeburg looks like from OpenLCEU, so that's cool, I guess. But we need to go find our airport. Shit. All right, Gombo, so that's the only screw-up you're getting today. You're not getting any belly landings or any of that nonsense. Today, I've flown you to the wrong airport, and that's about as good as it's going to get for you. Rolio's back. No, your eyes are not deceiving you. I'm actually trying to fly a 737. I just pulled to Southwest. What's that incident Southwest did a few years back where they were landing at some airport or whatever, and there was like a small like GA airport in front of it? So they just landed there, and then they didn't realize it somehow until after they stopped the thing at the opposite end of the threshold that they landed at the wrong airport. So I basically just pulled that. Luckily for me, I was going to do a flyover of the airport before approaching, so you can only imagine if I approached and landed at the airport and then realized, oh, whoops. So that was my bad. We're now flying to Magdeburg. My fault. I was approaching the wrong airport there like a dummy. Now we're on track. This happens when you run your mouth too much. You don't pay attention to what you're doing. Okay. So yes, we are en route to Magdeburg now, this time, I promise. Look at those lovely prepared cloud shadows on the ground there. That's such a nice touch. And we're leaving Magdeburg behind for Magdeburg. Hopefully I'm pronouncing that right too, by the way. Alright, there's a little airport. Oh, we found it. We can get rid of the little autopilot here and just go in and hand fly here. There she is. And look at how it blends in with OpenLC Europe, by the way. It's a lot of green down there, but the blending looks very nice. Actually, I think I see a line here. Is that a line? Does anyone else see a line going down here like that? Or is that just me? I thought I saw a line there. Wasn't sure. But, yeah, the blending is seamless. Look at that. Where does OpenLC end and the scenery begin? I do not know. But that blending is very well done. Look at that blending. Very nicely done. So for you guys tuning in from Germany, finally you get to see me do a live stream of something in Germany, huh? It's been a while since an airport in Germany was released. German airports team just aren't on their game like they used to be. There is a new German developer called German Airports. What is it called? I did write about them in AirDailyX recently. I think they're doing, is it Dresden or Nuremberg? I don't remember. But there is a new German developer on the scene. And in fact, I'm just waiting on them to release some new updates on their project. I think it's called German Scenery Design or something like that. Is it like GSD? Something like that. I think it's like German Scenery Design. Let's see. I am going to need some brakes coming in on this runway. Can anyone tell me, is anyone flying scheduled flights here? Did I read somewhere that Germania, I think, was, or something like that? This is a cute little airport. Boy, look at that countryside. Isn't that pretty? Hey, Captain Gombo, three green over there, okay? You see three green, so don't get started. Alright, there's our little runway coming into view there. Look at those cloud shadows on the terrain. That's very nice. You guys that don't have P3D, you're missing out. So, finally, Captain Sevens has gotten his second project out, along with 29 Palms. Very, very happy about that. Look at that approach. Look at that. This is very, very nicely done. Look at that nicely trimmed lawn there as we approach. Very nicely done. This is like a real funky landing I'm trying to do here. Ladies and gentlemen, I'd like to welcome you to Magdeburg, finally. Let's take a look at, look at these lovely summertime dandelions out here. What do they call these things? Are they dandelions? Very nice. Very nice. Look at some of the second. Look at some of these textures here. Looking good. Ooh, got some custom trees out there. It's actually a better idea. Sometimes I always start at the airport with a helicopter, but I think for live streams, I think it's better to kind of fly in. That way you get an idea of what it's like kind of pulling up to the main terminal from the virtual cockpit perspective. And let's see, which one of these lines should I be following here? Boy, look at, I mean, just look how well everything blends in together there. Should we try out GSX? Let's see what happens if we try GSX. Oh, you know what? I should start the auto, the APU, shouldn't I? Ah, screw it. We'll just run out of power. Alright, so here we are, folks. Let's see. Let's try GSX. Let's just get an idea. See how these guys come up. Is it Control F12? Sometimes I forget. There we go. Alright. Got our little GSX guys pulling up here. This is one thing that annoys me with GSX. See how that other truck is like sunken in the terrain? I always get some crazy nonsense like that. Can never seem to understand why it does that. Look at this guy. His baggage carts are just stuck in the ground. That's really weird. Let's see here. Let's open up some doors, shall we? Let's see. Wheel chocks. Main door. Now we can open this door, which opened up during flight at some point. My airplane doesn't have any more power because I didn't start up my APU when I was on approach like I was supposed to, so who cares? Let's see, cargo doors. There we go. See, the little bags are going to come out, I think. So this little truck here driving through the other truck, this is actually part of the scenery. And you have animated, I don't know if I should call it people flow or not, because I don't know if that's a trademark thing on behalf of Orbix or not. But, yeah, they have their own inside of the actual airport itself. He has his own animated guys walking around. And from what I understand, this is not easy to do. Is this a girl? Oh, it is. It's a supervisor walking around the ramp here. Look at her little strut. Look how she's strutting, shaking her hips as she walks. That's cute. All right, so that's pretty much it. We are here, and let's see. I should maybe hop into a little helicopter, or should I get Bob? I feel like I should get into Bob or something like that to move around. I do kind of want to see a little bit of the surrounding areas, too, though. So anyway, your GSX will show up very nicely here. There you go. I'm going to switch aircraft now on the risk of running out of memory. Hopefully I won't. Let's see here. Let's grab a quick helicopter. Let's try the AW-109. I don't think that's a helicopter I've actually used in a stream yet. Oops. No, it's not going to come up like that, huh? Oh, here we go. Yeah, that'll work. So I think the big question here, and let's see, let's do the cheat. That's a quick way to get the engine started. I guess my big thing here would be, once Captain Sevens became a part of 29 Palms, I'm really curious in terms of, you know, where the other enhancements were. I mean, in the actual manager, or the control panel, I should say, one of the things that you'll notice, obviously, you have your animated people. There are, I think, some scenery object libraries and stuff like that. Where's my lights? I should turn some lights on in here. There we go. I don't need to turn on everything. So I know there are certain things that are sort of signature to 29 Palms that were definitely added as part of the scenery, without a doubt. But I wonder what else might have been added as well. A part of me wonders if part of the collaboration was just to kind of help get the scenery out. Because I know, like I said in the beginning of the stream, when you have independent developers, sometimes it takes a while because you're just kind of working at your own pace. And when you have more of a team, things get done faster. So we're kind of right at the edge of the coverage area here, so you can see that blending. I mean, when you're up in the airplane, you can see how seamless it is. Once you're closer to the ground, you get a little bit of an idea. That road there, I think, is the actual edge of the coverage area, which is why I think there's some trees on it. I'm guessing these tall trees are part of the scenery and not part of open land class. That's what it looks like from here. So some of these taller trees are placed on the road for some reason. But yeah, these are definitely, these sort of taller trees are definitely part of the scenery. This is kind of a nice road, the way this leads into the airport with like all these trees and stuff surrounding it. That's pretty cool. Just look how sort of sharp the grass area is around here. Very, very sharp. There's your airport perimeter fence, one of the things that everyone knows I'm really keen to make a big deal about. The fences are there, very nice. I don't think 29 Palms has ever given me anything to complain about, though. And in case you missed it, I actually had a nice interview with Lars, who's one of the lead developers of 29 Palms, when he released his 29 Palms Airport in Southern California. Very informative, and a lot of history about the developer, how they got started, so make sure you check out that stream as well via our YouTube channel. And I think it's interesting because I think Lars was saying he had never actually been to 29 Palms. But one of the things that I pointed out in that interview with him is where they first got their start, which is a small little airfield up in Chile, in the middle of nowhere, literally. And all it is just one little kind of building and a runway and not much. And he managed to go from that to just becoming one of the community's highest developers. Between him and Martin, their dynamic duo, being one of the top teams in flight simulation in an extraordinarily short period of time. Extremely impressive how quickly they grew in such a short period of time. Very, very impressive. So I definitely like how you have these sort of tree-lined fields here as opposed to just leaving that to photoreel. They actually did go in and clean up the image quite a bit and place these custom trees out here. See some wind farms out there. I'm not sure if those are part of the scenery or OpenLC. That's probably OpenLC there in the background, if I had to guess. You'll also notice there's a couple of lakes down there. And those lakes are an option in the control panel also. If you don't have another area that sort of covers the region, I think you can go onto the control panel and it'll add those lakes in if they're not added naturally. I'm assuming those lakes are not there or correctly placed in default flight simulator. That's my guess. Here, just kind of flying over some of the photoreel there. You can see how sharp that is. So yeah, see there, you guys talking about some hills. There's a few small hills in the area, in the background there. But yeah, the area is mostly flat, but covered very nicely. I think actually a nice sortie. I wonder how far. Hey, I know Gombo knows the answer to this question. How far is Paderborn from here? Let me see if I can pronounce this right. Is it Paderborn Liebstadt? I don't know. I'm just guessing that's how it's pronounced. I'm probably way off. But how far is Paderborn from here? Just out of curiosity. I don't think I have it installed, but that's one of my favorite German airports, Paderborn. Let's see here. Is this a hotel? What does that say? Airport something. Airport. Oh, I guess that's airport offices, huh? That's what it looks like. I guess those are the airport offices. I guess no hotel out here, huh? I like the way the roads were done, too, by the way. Very nice. Lots of custom trees. Not a terribly big airport, but for its size, the quality is incredible. There's the birds. You guys see those birds there? That's also part of the configuration manager. You can have those birds in or out. I think the performance impact was negligible. Here we have our very nice looking parking lot and fences. Very nice. There's a nice little bus stop there. Some road signage down here. In a minute, we're going to get up and close and personal with that terminal. Like in the parking lot, have our little control tower. And also, you do have the option to have these animated vehicles and buses, which you can either have implemented or removed. But who wouldn't want these nice buses? Absolutely, why not? Looks very nice. Another little parking lot here along with the custom vegetation. Lots of custom vegetation in this scenery. Oh, Captain Gombo says my pronunciation of Paderborn Liebstadt was actually quite good. You know, I was guessing. You know, it's actually quite funny. Of all the languages I've always wanted to learn, German has always been number one on my list. Fortunately, it was never really offered in any of in high school. All they wanted to offer was French and Spanish, and I should have learned French. I rejected Spanish outright, so I didn't. But I wanted German, and no one was offering German, so a little disappointed. Especially given all my trips, you know, I've just picked up words here and there. But sometimes I'm pretty good at just reading German and pronouncing it and not knowing what I'm reading. So that's good. Glad I pronounced that right. French is confusing. French, I could never read a word in French and get it right. I remember when I was 13 and I saw the word Marseille written for the first time. And I was like, oh, Marcellis. French is just difficult. I think Germans would be a little bit easier, at least for me to learn. So you have a lot of nice little objects here out on the ramp. Wooden pallets, containers, nice library of various objects. And whereas there does not appear to be internal modeling, it is... Ooh, crashing my helicopter here. The glass is... Actually, maybe there is internal modeling. I can see that the glass is transparent, but I can't tell if there's internal modeling or not. That's what we're about to find out. It's kind of hard to see here. Let me just back up here. I see some wooden floors. Some images of ticket counters, Germania. I guess those would be your what was that, charter flights? All I see is Germania. Are they really the only airline flying through here? So the internal modeling here is very subtle. It's very nice. I mean, I would much prefer it done like this than just having those matte windows. I mean, they didn't put a whole lot of detail in there, but just enough for you to be able to see inside and see, you know, basic details. So very well done. I like the shading of the textures. You can see the specular mapping there. Nice little shine and gloss on the windows. So if we just compare this to Heringsdorf, where we took off from earlier today, you can already see how far this developer has come. I mean, for the most part, I would probably say the airport was 90% complete before 29 Palms came on board and, you know, made it beautiful. Not that it already wasn't, but, you know, 29 Palms just adds that little extra touch that just really sends it right over the edge of the cliff. Such as the animated guys walking around there with the phone, and there's a couple of guys here walking around with the phone, actually. Look at the quality of that texturing. I mean, Captain Sevens is really, really knocking him out of the park. This is only his second release, but, I mean, just look at how good that is. Texturing's very, very nicely done. I couldn't wait to get my hands on this scenery. A lot of detail. There we have the fire station here. Let me see if I can back us up a little bit so we can take a look at some of those other objects we saw earlier. Not sure what all that is. I guess those are just cargo pallets with freight on them. That's what it looks like. Oh, am I going through a building here? I guess I am. Totally digging those fences and gates. Obviously the library cars looking very good. Here, let's see, we have a little trucking warehouse. I mean, the quality here is good enough. Captain Sevens could just straight go out and do, like, you know, Nuremberg or something. That's an airport we seriously need. Damn, I don't know what's taken so long for somebody to develop a proper Nuremberg. It's been way too long. The German airport scene version is just way too old. But I could see Captain Sevens taking on Nuremberg. Absolutely. I'm trying to remember off the top of my head how long the development process was for this airport, but I'm trying to remember if I covered some of this on the old blog or if it was all with the new website. I can't remember. Because if it was with the old blog, then that puts this well over a year and a half into development. So I'm going to have to go back and research that. So here you have your tractor trailers here, or lorry trailers, depending on where you're from. Let's come over here and take a look at this hangar. Again, very well done on the shading. You have some nice cars in the lot there. Looks like a VW Scirocco. A little BMW, what was that, a 3 Series over there, looks like. I thought this was a hangar. I guess it's not a hangar. It looks like just a logistics facility. It looked like a hangar. There's a little aircraft parked in here. A little logistics airplane that actually says logistics. It's like a, what is that, a C-208? Air Logistics. I wonder where they fly to. Interesting. Let's go ahead and manipulate some of the lighting here. Let's see, take a quick look at some comments here. Captain Gombo says he dreams of a new version of Munich. Is the version by German Airports team really not good enough? I quite liked it. I mean, I loved how they did the taxi bridges, how the traffic goes under all the bridges and all that. Who, Captain Gombo, who would you elect to do a new Munich? Maybe Flight Beam? I know we're all waiting to see that Flight Beam Frankfurt come out. I'm just going to die when that comes out. I know that's going to be just amazing. I really can't wait for that. Let's see here. Let's take a look at some of the other comments here. Try to scroll back up. Oh, so, okay, so Paderberg, I'm sorry, Paderberg, Magdeburg to Paderborn is roughly 195 kilometers. Good to know. Sorry, just scrolling through some of the comments here while I try to fly at the same time. Not easy. Oh, Atacama de Chile. Oh, Sid is here. What's up, Sid? There we go. He says Atacama de Chile was the name of 29 Palms' first offering. I believe, in fact, it would be cool if they expanded on it at a bit more of the driest place on Earth, such as... such as in all those telescope observatories, the world's most powerful hotels in the area, and another airport high in the Andes. It's not easy trying to fly a helicopter while looking at another screen at the same time and reading. Happy Meadows here. Flight Tampa, Flight Beam, 29 Palms. I think 29 Palms would totally massacre Munich. I think that would be incredible. I don't think 29 Palms has done an airport that big, though. I mean, I think the biggest they've done so far is Berlin-Brandenburg, and that was really kick-ass. I know they did that with, what's that group? Lime Sim. So, yeah, I mean, those two coming together and doing a new Munich, man. Yeah, they'd totally do a killer job on that. No, Rolio, we're not going to crash. I think I can still try and multitask here. All right, so let's go ahead and take a look. I'm going to fool around with the lighting a little bit and see what happens. Look at those clouds. Isn't that awesome? Alright, so we got some night lighting here. Can anyone tell me if Magdeburg operates at night? I think that'd be a good question to ask. I do see there are some runway lights, but they seem rather dim though. For any nighttime operations. I'm sure one of you guys can look that up for me. Actually, no, I see it now. Okay, I guess when you're flying over, it doesn't look that bright, but now that we're coming under the approach here, we can see the custom lighting coming in. There we go. Yeah, so I guess, yeah, looks like there's some nice nighttime approach lighting here. There we go. All custom done, too. Lovely. Let's see if we can get a little bit closer to the ground and take a look at some of these lights up close. And there's a Poppy's. All custom work done. Wow, these night lights are actually really nice. In fact, let me get a little bit closer to here. I'm going to hit the pause button for a second. Yeah, I just want to get just kind of close to some of these lights. Look at that. I like how these are lit and how they cast kind of like a little light on the ground around them. Very nicely done. These edge lights here, and then you have these center lights, which just kind of pop out of the ground, I guess. Yeah, kudos on the night lighting. I love the custom night lighting. Very well done. And we'll get a little bit closer to the terminal here. There, you can see your animated vehicles. You can see there how, look at the little light they cast in front of them. Nice. I mean, it's a small airport, but it's really so well done. Incredibly well done. And this building is really interesting. It looks like kind of a temporary building here. You just have the air conditioning systems outside. Is this our friend there? She's still outside there. Yeah, you got your people walking around. And those are just the little things that really can take a scenery and make it something special. Having all that little extra bit of activity going on around. Back out to the parking lots here. That's pretty much it in a nutshell. So what we're going to do now is I'm going to stop the simulator, and then we're gonna pull up the control panel so you can take a quick look at that. And then we'll take a look at the winter textures here. Let's take a look at the winter textures now. Let's see. Thought it would be a good idea to take a look at the pitch black nighting before we go. That night lighting is really well done. Look at that. And you can see there's some little light hueing here going on at the top. Yeah, the night lighting here is really well done. Very well done. Very nice. You can see how the lights from the overhead sort of cast a little bit of light onto the building as well. I'm starting to see more and more developers start to do that, and I'm really glad that they are. That's one of the things, like in Orbix Hilltop there, inside the hangar, was really well done. Actually, it's not called Hilltop. It's called Limberlost Ranch is what it's called. But nevertheless, I was really impressed with how they did that. Very nice. I mean, you have a light here and how the light underneath it just sort of casts light onto the building. I love the way that's done. Very nice. Okay, let's take a look at the winter textures, and that's it. And hopefully, if I can get Liberia back, get that back before the within the next hour or so, then we can take a look at Liberia. Let's go ahead and close that. Yes, we want to exit prepared. And then let's go over and take a look. So here we have our 29 Palms configuration panel. Oh, it still thinks it's running. Come on. Where's prepared? Get out of here, don't you? All right, here we go. There we go. So this is our nice little configuration tool. So as you can see right now, I have Magdeburg and 29 Palms. 29 Palms, by the way. God, I love this airport. In fact, I did a flight into 29 Palms from Sedona last night. So if you have Sedona, you really should get 29 Palms. Those two match up nicely. And of course, 29 Palms is really close to Palm Springs. But anyway, Magdeburg. So we have approach and runway lights. You have an option of standard or having them on all the time. And here it shows you the differences here of standard and always on. So that's standard. Approach and runway lights are activated during dusk, dawn, and nighttime. You might miss the lights during low visibility conditions at daytime, which makes good sense, especially if it's foggy. So actually, I might just turn that always on. And then taxiway system, you have standard and experimental. So standard means activates a standard taxiway system, which works fine but doesn't incorporate correct movement of AI traffic at the drive-through parking spots. So you can go with experimental, and experimental activates an experimental taxiway system which allows correct movements of AI aircraft at the parking spots but might lead to some unexpected behavior under certain conditions. Doesn't hurt your PC. You can fly it. You can try it with or without them. Let's turn those on. Static objects such as apron, which we have on, all these nice little things here. Some static aircraft out there, which is nice. What is that, by the way? That's like an old Learjet, huh? An old Gulfstream. And then, of course, we have our beautiful 3D people. That's our lovely Sally there, who was doing her strut earlier that we saw. Apron vehicles, animated. Landside traffic, which is our cool buses that we saw, and the birds that we got a quick glimpse at. And then the terrain extension that I talked about a little bit earlier, nearby lakes. If you don't have a third-party terrain or land class add-on installed, simply check this option to add 3 nearby lakes. Performance impact, none. So I do have it checked. Obviously, they were there. I have OpenLC Europe, so I imagine that puts them in. Not really sure, but nevertheless, good to have. You have your documentation here. Let's see what's all in here. Your introduction. Thank you for purchasing Magdeburg 2015. This airport scenery is the first product that has been developed as part of cooperation between 29 Palms, Lawrence Pickenberg, and Captain 7, Volker Wegner. We paid much attention to the details to give you the best possible rendition of the airport within your simulator, while keeping a fluid performance always in mind. The airport is currently being extended with a couple of logistics facilities. The scenery reflects the state of late 2014, and we may deliver a scenery update later on in order to keep up with the scenery with its real counterpart. We hope that you like this scenery. For any feedback or support requests, please register an account at 29 Palms at 29palms-forum.de. We will be glad to help you. And then it goes on to the rest of the blah, 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 blah. On May 26, 1994, the airport was given an operating license as a commercial airport with Class D airspace and a full day and night operation. So that answers my earlier question. Obviously, I didn't read the manual. From November 1997 until early 1999, the operations were suspended due to a complete refurbishment of the airport, including runway, apron, taxiways, and the control tower. In June 2000, an instrument rating system, or instrument landing system, ILS Category 1, and high-performance approach lights were put into operation, allowing operation under instrument flight rules. In the summer of 2001, a new fire station was put into operation and the construction of a new terminal building for the general aviation has been completed. In 2015, it is planned to offer several holiday flights to Antalya, Rome, or Dubai. What the? Who's going to fly Dubai? Wow, could you imagine that? I guess that's like in an A320 or something, huh? Besides that, air freight logistics and business flights common among the movements at Magdeburg. Let's see if I can pronounce this. Kochstadt. I don't know if I pronounced that right or not. Anyway, here are your airport parking positions. Gets into a lot of bit of that information. Recommended flight simulator settings. I think all of my simulator settings are almost all maxed out. Use the scenery configurator as described on page 6 in the settings menu for 2048 or 4096. Mines are actually set for 4096, so you kind of saw it the way they meant for you to see it. Let's see. That's pretty much it. Look at those lovely flowers there. It talks a little bit about the configuration tool, blah, 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 blah. And here you have your lovely beta testers, your groups there. Daryl Shepard, I know that guy. Lars Nissen there. Who else is in here? Emilios. Who else is in here? And special thanks to Arnold Garrison. I see this a lot in a lot of special thanks from different developers, and always glad to see that, because this guy, Arnold Garrison, you would think that this guy would be, like, literally the number one senior developer in the whole of flight simulation. Like, this guy, he doesn't seem to develop anything. I don't get it with Arnold. It's kind of weird, because he really is, like, singular. He's the guy who comes up with all of the development techniques that everyone adopts. For example, texture baking. I think he was the very first person to introduce the concept of texture baking, and now I don't think there's any developer that doesn't use texture baking. So Arnold, he like comes up with all this really, really cool development techniques and everyone follows it, but yet, you know, and he runs FS Developer, obviously, that's his inception, but he doesn't develop anything to my knowledge. Like, I don't know if I could go out there and find a scenery or something that he's developed, but could you imagine, like, if Arnold decided, okay, I'm going to do this Payware airport and release it. Like, I imagine it would just be super, just blow my mind awesome, but I don't think he's ever done anything, at least not that I'm aware of. But nevertheless, always good to see Arnold Garrison's name in there, because quite naturally a lot of the techniques that many developers use today were developed and discovered by Arnold. So very good. So copyright 2015 Captain 7 Flight Sim Destinations Volker Ragnar and 29 Palm Senior Designs. So I'm really hoping to see these guys work together again in the future. Really looking forward to that. You've got some charts here as well. Very helpful stuff. None of which I obviously use flying into the wrong airport. All right, so now we're going to go over to the global settings. And this is where you can now switch your seasons. And now we're going to go for winter and done. So that was quick. Another good thing that I really like about this configuration panel as well is if you need to update anything. Wait, where is it? Oh. You can click this thing there, and you can actually check for updates. I actually did it before I started the stream. So, yep, all seniors are up to date. But you can literally update everything from here. So if they add anything new or any updates or anything like that to any of their products, you can click a button, and boom, it's good to go. So cool, cool, cool stuff. All right, so that's that. So we're going to close that out. We're going to restart prepared, and now we're going to take a quick look at the winter textures. And we're now going into 2 hours, so the video is pretty much going to split from here. And if you want to catch the winter textures, make sure you stay tuned for the second half of the video for those of you watching on YouTube, because YouTube cuts me off at 2 hours. And for those of you watching live, just stick around for a little bit longer and we will take a look at the winter textures. And while we wait, let's take a quick look at some comments. Oh, Captain Gumbo says if they're allowed to, Emirates would probably fly a 777. Oh, I know they would. They'd probably try to jam a freaking A380 in there the way they act. All right. Let's see. So it looks like a lot of people are voting 29 palms to take on Munich.